Coming up next, Webster.
Good morning. It is a fateful day, an historic day in the history of Canada. Not quite easy to grasp all the details. As of this moment, however, we think we've got a pretty good rundown. We're going to cover Chretien's press conference in Ottawa very shortly live, and he should have the answers to all the questions as we now think we have. And I have, thank goodness, with me two experts who have split their own court, the Honourable J.V. Clyne and the Right Honourable Joey Smallwood, former Premier of Newfoundland. And I'll be back with the continued coverage of the constitutional question after the break.
You're wrong on that, right?
Are you on? No one can be blamed if they are somewhat confused with what is happening this morning. Simply put, it seems to be this, that the Supreme Court of Canada, in all its wisdom, has agreed 9-0 that the federal propositions do interfere with provincial powers and rights. That was conceded earlier by the federal government when they made their presentation to the Supreme Court. It seems to have concluded, too, that there is a constitutional convention that the provinces must agree to changes affecting them 6-3. But then the other one is that it's apparently, the Supreme Court has apparently ruled that it is legal for the federal parliament to go unilaterally to London with its full package, the amending formula, the Charter of Rights, the whole kit and caboodle. And it does leave one in a slightly confused state, which is why I'm very glad that this morning I have here Mr. Smallwood and Mr. Clyne. Now, Mr. Smallwood, I apologize for not being able to tell you the answer to the question for which you are sitting on edge all agog. And that's the question is, can the federal parliament change unilaterally the terms of union under which you and your party brought Newfoundland into Confederation?
And do it without consulting Newfoundland or getting Newfoundland's consent. Mm-hmm. Look, I helped to draft those terms of union with Canada. I signed them. And I'm therefore partly responsible for them. I think there's only one man left in the world in Newfoundlander who signed those terms besides myself, the former Lieutenant Governor, Gordon Winter. If I found that the Parliament of Canada can in fact change one letter, one syllable of those terms without the free and willing consent of the Newfoundland government, I would turn anti-federal, and I'm a federalist to the tips of my fingers now. B, I would turn anti-liberal, and I'm a liberal born. C, I would turn anti-Trudeau, and I believe, up to this moment, he's the greatest Canadian prime minister since Sir John A. Macdonald. I would turn against them all. I would cease to be a Canadian and become a Newfoundlander. But whereas now, I'm very ardent in my Canadianism.
But at the same time, if I can just put this to Mr. Newfoundland, and you can have at him, you seem to accept the fact that it's perfectly proper on the 7-2 vote for the federal parliament to go unilaterally to London, in which case they could also change your terms of reference, terms of union.
No, not if they have the... To go to the Parliament of the United Kingdom and ask them to amend the BNA Act and send it back to Canada does not give them the right. They're not asking for the right to change our terms of union.
Let's go to Mr. Klein's interpretation of what's happened this morning, first of all.
Oh, well, I think that what has been said very shortly is that the British the Supreme Court of Canada has said that it is legal for the for the Parliament, the Canadian government, to go to the British Parliament to change the BNA Act, but it is not right for them to do so. Now, I just want to comment on what Mr. Smallwood has said, because up to date, we haven't agreed. But now I agree with him that they cannot, the Canadian government cannot go to the UK without the consent of the of Newfoundland.
No, I didn't now, say that. I didn't say that.
Well, I gather that's what you said.
With or without the consent of Newfoundland, with or without the consent of any of the provinces.
Providing they don't change the terms of union that you sign.
Or have the right to do it.
Let me ask you,
but they're going to change the terms very definitely if they incorporate the Charter of Human Rights.
No. If the people of Newfoundland, either in a referendum,
yes,
or the legislature of Newfoundland, either or both, if they agree, then I'm all for that.
But let me ask them a question.
What I would object to is the Parliament of Canada having the right to amend our terms of union,
yes,
without our consent.
That's right.
Yes.
Well, they are doing so if they pass they are if they pass the Charter.
No, I don't think
rights.
Not for a moment.
Well, haven't read it.
Let me ask a question, sir, and there's nothing intended by the question. Is the Supreme Court of Canada, however, from a layman's point of view, not guilty of obfuscation this morning? How is one to understand it when it's legal, but there is a convention?
Well, I think that they have done something that I didn't expect them to do, but I think is right for a court to do. In other words, they've said, we've looked at this whole thing, and technically, it is legal, but morally, it is not.
Look, I have a very bright young N.D.P. fellow on the phone right now from Ottawa, and we haven't had any N.D.P. reaction, and it's Svend Robinson, Vancouver MP. Svend.
Good morning, Jack.
Svend, we're a bit confused here. Perhaps you can tell us. What, first of all, is your party's reaction to what happened in the Supreme Court of Canada this morning?
Well, we're going to be meeting as a caucus to...
This is not our morning, gentlemen, is it?
Well, isn't that extraordinary?
That's quite extraordinary, because that was our
call. So long as it's happening also to the CBC.
You'll be happy.
I won't mind. So
that's the main thing.
The CBC has set you a bad example.
I am not the least bit confused about what's happening if they go to London, because surely if they go to London, we have dire predictions of what's going to happen with the interference of provincial rights in the Charter.
Yes.
The language question, for instance, if this goes through, that means that 101, the strongest weapon in the arsenal of the Quebec government, is attacked, and surely that's a very divisive factor from here on in. Mr. Smallwood.
No, I don't agree. I just disagree strongly. Are we a democratic people? Are we a democrat nation? Do we want a Charter of Rights? Do we want equal rights? Freedom of conscience, of speech, of religious belief, of language, and
of
so
course,
on.
Of course, sir.
If we do, let's have it.
You're praising motherhood.
Well, let's have it.
Yes, but Mr. Smallwood.
Let's have it.
Does your agreement, whereby Newfoundland entered into Confederation, provide that the powers of the provinces and the federal government is set out in sections 91 and 92?
Yes.
It does. Well, then, this Charter of Human Rights radically alters the powers contained in sections 91 and 92. Therefore, I am following you in saying that the federal government cannot move to Parliament in England without the consent of Newfoundland in the alteration of those powers.
Let me ask a question. Does
The British North America Act was amended with and I helped to draw the amendment.
Yes, I can remember that very
well. The BNA Act was amended to admit Newfoundland in.
Yes.
And that was done by amending the BNA Act.
Yes.
And this was amended by the Parliament of the United Kingdom. Nobody else could. But it was done at the request of the Parliament of Canada.
Yes.
It was amended. Now, we came under the BNA Act and provided always that the terms under which we entered the Union are not abrogated, not weakened, not ended, not changed, not amended except with our absolute consent.
And now the government...
I don't care what changes they make of those that have been proposed up to now. There might be some proposed that I wouldn't agree with, but I do agree with all that have been proposed.
We are getting
all that they're asking the British Parliament to enact.
But we are getting off the point, gentlemen. We are now faced with what seems to be, at the very least, a confusing situation. It's not the clear-cut decision everyone wanted, is it?
But it may be once you see it. We haven't seen it. It's 100 pages. And we've heard a few spasmodic remarks on television and radio. That's all we've heard.
Well, here's a guy who's in Ottawa, presumably knows it all. Can you give me yet the NDP position, Svend Robinson, on this morning's decisions in the Supreme Court?
Well, Jack, I'm sorry, we were cut off when I spoke with you before, so I don't know how much I actually said.
You said nothing, actually, so just start at the beginning.
Okay, well, first of all, there's been a tremendous amount of bafflegab and confusion and misleading statements about the decisions, I think partly because of people haven't had a chance to read them.
That's it.
I've got the decisions in front of me, and I say decisions because they've basically been four separate decisions in front of me at my desk. And here's the long and the short of it, Jack. The fact of the matter is that courts are there to determine whether something is legal or illegal. The provinces went before the courts and asked the courts whether or not this was legal. They also asked about conventions, but from the perspective I think the most important perspective is it legal? The answer of the court was overwhelmingly, by a vote of 7-2, yes, this is legal. Now, there are some who go on to say, but, well, they said that there were conventions which were being violated in this process. Well, there, Jack, and they talk about morality and tradition and everything else. What we have to bear in mind is that this is the first time in the history of our nation that we've ever attempted to do anything of this nature. So I don't really see where we can talk about traditions and conventions and so on when we're dealing with something which is really a very new process.
Can you tell me the answer to the Newfoundland question?
The answer to the Newfoundland question was that it would, I've got it right here in front of me, Jack, the judgment on the Newfoundland question.
Could you read it out?
Could you read it out for Premier Smallwood?
Well, okay, what it says is, the answer precisely is, as expressed in the reasons of the Newfoundland Court of Appeal, subject to the correction made in reasons of this court. In other words, they have agreed with the decision of the Newfoundland Court of Appeal on question four.
And that agreement means that the terms of the union cannot be interfered with.
No, the other way.
The other way.
Well, ask.
No.
Tell us.
No, that was missing.
Svend.
Yes?
Give us the actual answer. What does that answer mean that you gave me, that they agree with the Newfoundland Court?
Well, the Newfoundland Court of Appeal said that, as I understand it, said that the terms of union cannot be interfered with.
Yeah, that's valid.
Are you happy now, Mr. Smallwood, if he's right?
Who said that they cannot be? Who said
Supreme,
that?
The Supreme Court, apparently.
Well, I say the same thing.
Yes.
So they and I are in perfect. Yeah. There are nine of them, and I'm one more, mm-hmm. making 10.
Right.
They cannot be interfered with.
And that is
we'd
that.
We'd have a revolution.
Is
we'd,
that.
We'd start a mutiny.
So therefore, the decision of the Supreme Court in Newfoundland is that the terms of union cannot be interfered with, Svend. Is that right?
That's correct.
That's good.
That's good. That's good.
So I don't have to turn anti-Trudeau, anti-federal, anti-liberal, anti-Canadian.
I want to turn to Auntie Sally to get the details of this judgment.
Well, that's what they said. They said, look, we agree with the Newfoundland Court of Appeal on that point, okay?
That's
now, there's another issue, Jack, which I think should be borne in mind, and that is that what the provinces were arguing here is that every single province had to agree. There had to be unanimity before there could be any constitutional change in this country.
Right.
And the fact of the matter is the Supreme Court said, no, that's not the case. Now, I hope, and I can't speak on behalf of the caucus will be meeting to decide what we do, but personally, I hope that we can put this matter behind us now. It's been held to be legal. We've got a good package on balance, and get on to the economic issues that are facing the country. Certainly that's the overwhelming view of the people of my constituency.
Svend, you've been a great help this morning, and I'm grateful, and we'll talk to you some other time at the Broadbent or whatever about your party's packaged response. Thank you, Svend Robinson.
Bye-bye, Jack.
I'll be back. Shall I take a break? I'll be back after these messages with more of the same. We are hopeful that we will go to the National Press Centre, just across from the Parliament buildings in Ottawa, where Mr. Chretien comes up to answer questions. Now, how much time he's had between, oh, it's just an hour since we first saw him in the lobby of the Supreme Court. Whether or not he's in a real position to interpret things for his government is something which remains to be seen. But I have here right now, and I'm one of the luckiest broadcasters in the country this morning, but because apart from Mr. Smallwood and Mr. Clyne, I've also got my friend, Professor Dr. Mr. Ed McWhinney, who, of course, as you know, is another distinguished constitutional expert. Can you make sense of it yet on the basic legality of the federal government's actions?
I think so, and in sum, it may not have been intended that way. It's really not a bad court decision. What they have given is a clear-cut, categorical answer on what they say is the legal issue. We're a court of law. They say the federal government's action is legal. But they leave open the question, and apparently may even decide the other way, is it constitutional in the political sense?
Conventional, you might
conventional
say.
Sense. But they have answered this question, is a convention binding at law? Dicey in 1885, the greatest English authority, said no, not binding at law, but various dire political consequences would follow. And the court has repeated this. And I would have thought that was categorical, that this package is perfectly legal because conventions are not binding at law. But they do say...
I'm the layman.
Yes.
I'm not confused by knowledge
yes.
on precedents. And that's
yes.
a good thing sometimes, Mr. Smallwood, isn't it? What you're saying is that the Supreme Court has said it's legal.
That's right.
You may go ahead and you may wish, if you so do, despite our 6-3 opposing judgment, ignore the convention.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
That's right. By 7-2, they said it's legal. And this was eminently predictable in advance. It was the only thing that was predictable, and they're categorical. As I say, every major English common law constitutional authority since 1885 has said this.
You're happy with Mr. McWhinney's interpretation, but you're unhappy with what you think will be the political consequences.
No, what I'm saying, and I agree with Dr. McWhinney, that as Dicey pointed out, there's a distinction between legal and moral requirements. And he has also pointed out that if a legislature proceeds without taking into regard the moral requirements, then it can be in trouble. And that is what would happen if the British Parliament proceeds legally but does not take into account the moral requirements and the moral effect on another country.
And to that, Mr. Smallwood
well,
says...
these moral requirements, the various governments and prime ministers of Canada have tried desperately for some 50 years to meet. And the provinces wouldn't. You can lead a horse to the well, but you can't make him drink. And the provinces in 50 years said no. Now, do we wait another 50 or do we go to it now?
I think the court has read, as far as I can interpret, I haven't read the opinions, but the court seems to have read a lecture on political morality to the participants and said this is a political problem. It's for the political arenas, and it will be solved in the political arenas by the voters and others. But as a matter of law, our lecture on political morality to one side, you have the green light to go ahead. So the ball is back with Mr. Trudeau. There's no issue.
Is he a winner or a loser?
Legally, he has won, but now comes the test of statesmanship. What will he do, granted the political psychological
Well, Professor,
facts?
Would you say that not that Mr. Trudeau has won, but rather that the Parliament of Canada has won?
The government of Canada.
Not the government, the Parliament.
Well, I'd agree on all those propositions.
Suggested and hinted at by the government.
The parliamentary majority.
That does it.
The parliamentary majority has won its position, and it is very, very...
The parliamentary
very...
majority is the Parliament.
That's right.
Yes, but if Mr. Trudeau should proceed on the basis of this judgment now and ask the British Parliament to change the Constitution, I think that the British Parliament has been placed in an impossible position because the Supreme Court of Canada has said this is legal, but it's not moral.
But then I think it must answer it at law, and that's what Mrs. Thatcher up to date has done. She has said, we will act on a request from the government of Canada, not the provinces, government of
from
Canada.
From the Parliament of Canada.
That's right.
Yes.
So in essence, what the court has said, we're a court of law, and here's the law. but they've also, as a sort of extended obiter dictum, read election political morality. Dicey's view was, in the end, the voters decide those issues. If a prime minister being defeated refuses to resign, the political process, he's taken care of it.
Yeah. You've raised the very point, of course, if I can divert for a moment, why many of us are not very keen on the Charter of Rights, and you're a great parliamentarian, Mr. Smallwood. If Mr. Trudeau, of whom you are a greatest admirer, you said he's the finest prime minister since Johnny McDonald. The greatest since Johnny McDonald. Do you not think his Charter of Rights down the road will eventually lead us into the U.S. constitutional type interpretation of the courts by judges when it should be done by people like you? In other words, we're giving our constitution into the judges.
Whatever judgment the Supreme Court gives, remember, can be changed by Parliament, in other words, by the people.
Not with the amending formula that is contained in this Trudeau document. That amending,
by the people? No,
because that amending formula is so rigid. It means that the Constitution
means that half the population of Canada in half the provinces of Canada can change it any time they want.
That is not right. Quebec has, if this goes through, Quebec and Ontario each will have a permanent veto. You go ahead.
And furthermore,
it's enormously complicated, and at the level of law and action, I think most people think it won't work. We'll have a rigid constitution.
Well, let's get back to the topic. Let me go around my distinguished panel and say to you, what will Mr. Trudeau, we're whistling in the dark, but after all, he's having a nap, or maybe he's not, maybe he's up studying the damn thing, but they said he was going to bed. What will he do, sir, with all your years of expertise behind you? And sagacity and wisdom and experience.
Well, you want the bottom line?
Yes.
He'll go to Britain, to the British Parliament. No, he will ask the Parliament of Canada to address a letter to Her Majesty the Queen, asking Her Majesty to be graciously pleased to lay before her United Kingdom Parliament, not her Australian or New Zealand, her United Kingdom Parliament, this request of the Parliament of Canada.
And he'll get it?
And
he'll
get it.
Mr. McWhinney?
He has that option, but look, in the last week, 2 weeks, he's shown quiet diplomacy can work. Alberta and Ottawa are at one, BC and Ottawa, one wouldn't have expected it. 3 days of successful negotiation. So he makes a bid to the provinces. The provinces also are chastened by this decision. It might be an interesting tack to take, but legally he can do exactly as Mr. Smallwood
said. Mr. Clyne.
No doubt about it, he can do this legally.
But you say he shouldn't do it.
But he should, well, no, he should not. Because I believe that this charter, if it is passed by the Parliament of England, will be divisive of this country. Now, what I do think, and I agree with Dr. McWhinney, that it would be wise for him now to call a meeting of the first ministers, and possibly they might be able to agree, let's bring the charter back, but leave out the Act back, but leave out the Charter of Rights.
You prepared to dispose of that, Mr. Smallwood?
Dispose of the Charter of Rights?
No, of his suggestion that Trudeau will back down.
I don't know what you mean by dispose. I don't agree. I want the Charter of Rights. I want it as a Canadian, as a human being, as a liberal, as a politician. I want the Charter of Rights for Canada.
Mm-hmm.
I do.
I think it's a dull, grey Bill of Rights. I'm disappointed with it. I don't agree with these doom and gloom people who say it'll bring the country to an end, but I think it's a very disappointing document, and if it has to be rewritten again with more poetry, more verve, and more succinctly, I think it would be an advantage.
More poetry and verve, perhaps
sure.
More clarity.
Yes, well, that all poetry is clarity, and distilled nicely. Yeah, Mr. Smallwood knows that.
As Mr. Smallwood said this morning when he got his first flashes of this on the interrupted network, he said, the whole thing's as clear as mud. And you were the first major politician quoted across the country with the first lucid interpretation of the
situation. No, but that was only because it was as clear as mud and no more.
Mm. It's not much better now.
But it's not a bad decision, because it says, in total, this is the law. But it then says there are other things too, and we're not.
In other words, this is a law, make your own damn political decision.
The political hot potatoes belong in other arenas than the courts.
I hope your gentleman will stay.
Now, talking about the United States, you know, one of the serious defects of the American system is that the Supreme Court of the United States doesn't only interpret law, they make law.
That's what will happen here.
Well, I think every court
does. The Alberta Press case makes law. Roncarelli makes law.
And Webster takes time for a commercial break. This is lesson number one in Learn Along with Webster on the constitutional decisions. Thank God I've got experts. Now we're going to see on the screen, in plain English language, a clear interpretation we trust of the questions and the answers so we can all understand. Now, I can just see them up there. Good, that's the Supreme Court. Do the proposals affect provincial powers and rights? The answer? Two, is there a convention, a kind of unwritten understanding that provinces must agree to changes affecting their powers and rights? Three, is there not just a convention but a legal requirement that affected provinces to agree to any such changes? Now the answers, give me them all again. Slap them up again and I'll give the answers. Can you do that? How long do you need to take to recue?
5 seconds.
5 seconds to recue. Put them up and then hold each one up and I'll give what we understand the answer is.
Just,
okay, I can do it quickly. Let's do it again. I'd rather be right than be Prime Minister of Canada. Well, yes, they do. 9-0. Is there a convention? Yes, there is. 6-3. In favor of. Is there a convention? Unwritten. 6-3. Is there a legal requirement that affected provinces must agree? No, there is not. 7-2. We've got it, gentlemen.
That's right.
Clear in my little pygmy brain. So maybe my remarks about the obfuscation of the Supreme Court of Canada weren't justified.
Quite possible.
And I don't know but what you should be cited for contempt in saying that the Supreme Court was guilty of obfuscation.
Well, let me put it this way, without assessing any blame on any organization with I'm connected in any way, shape, or form, that it was rather obfuscated this morning as we tried to understand it. It's an answer.
Yes. Yes, it was.
It's a collegial body, and one almost has the suspicion that they arranged it that way to give a little on each side, but still within the parameters of that categorical legal answer.
Oh, I don't understand that. Do you mean they were expedient?
They have many judicial conferences before they finally decide, and votes do change.
In other words, the Supreme Court of Canada has to do its own jury room work.
It's almost a dialectical process.
You read the Brethren?
Yes, I've read the Brethren.
Yeah, well, that'll tell you something.
Oh, but that's in the United States, sir.
I know, but
Jack, I think on balance, and I'll repeat this, I think I'm the first to say it, I don't think it's such a bad decision. I think it's a rather wise, statesman-like decision on balance. If you add up those elements in it.
But if I can now put it back into the political part, yeah. Trudeau and Correa, whatever he is, and Chretien and company, now have to decide whether they're prepared to continue to face the divisiveness in Quebec especially.
Whether they're prepared to exercise a legal right, an undoubted legal right, with regard to political psychological consequences, which they now have to quantify. They now have to really decide, is it worth it politically?
Who would want to be Prime Minister of this country
I would
today?
Say that it's lucky that we have, as Prime Minister, the man who is Prime Minister, to grapple with that very problem of Quebec. Who else could grapple with it?
I'm not worried by that effect on Quebec's language law, though. This is pretty academic, because Lebec had conceded as early as 1978 the right of English-speaking parents outside the province moving to Quebec to have their children educated in English. He'd conceded that politically in 78. He simply said, I want a quid pro quo. He never got it. And the fact that this charter cuts that down, I think it's a gain for Canada.
But does not this put the British Parliament, if Mr. Trudeau elects to proceed now, would this not put the British Parliament in a most invidious position? Because they're faced with something that the Supreme Court has said is legally right, but in the words of Aidan Dicey, morally wrong.
I think
but
they
doctor,
have.
Now,
wait a minute. I want to ask.
Yes, please.
I think there are only two solutions there. You get into the merits. The political merits,
exactly.
Or you play it by the law.
Exactly.
And Mrs. Thatcher said, I'll play it by
exactly.
the law, and the political merits are irrelevant.
Look, dare
well,
the
that's
Parliament.
That's the safest position.
Safest for her, but it's
the constitutional position.
I'm the chairman here.
Yes. Dare the Parliament of the United Kingdom enter into the pros and cons, who was for it and who was against it, They get a request from the Parliament of Canada, which a country that has only one parliament. And that parliament requests them to amend a particular act, not any act, but an act of the United Kingdom Parliament passed more than 100 years ago about Canada. And Canada's parliament asks them to amend it. Dare they refuse?
Yes.
And dare they delay or hesitate?
If I were a member of the British Parliament, I would dare to refuse because
and you'd
of
vote
this.
Against. I would 98%
say that,
vote
Jack,
for.
I would say that I'm being asked to do something that is legally right but morally wrong.
Jack,
and if I have to make that choice, I will say that I will not do something that is morally wrong.
I think 12 months ago she should have said to Mr. Trudeau, "You're independent. It's none of our affair. It's for you to make your own constitutional changes."
Gentlemen,
but she didn't, and now she is stuck with
the law. No point in looking at the past. We must look positively for the future of this nation. Right, sir?
Right.
Now, we are now going into the National Press Center in Ottawa to watch Jean Chretien perform, and the word is that he has already consulted with his prime minister in Seoul, if that's how you pronounce it, in Korea. And momentarily, said Webster, we shall see Jean Chretien, a most admirable, engaging fellow. I sometimes think his accent is put on a little bit thick,
like
because he's an excellent and fluent English speaker nowadays.
And a good fellow.
And a delightful chap. Where are they? Come on. They're waiting for Chretien. Well,
you know, Trudeau should be home doing this.
Should Trudeau have gone to bed for a sleep?
Did he go?
We don't know, do we?
Did you know how we sleep with Chretien, do you suppose?
You know how we sensational, snide media people tend to take cheap shots whenever we
He's
can.
Wise to read the judgment, nevertheless,
yes,
whether it's by accident.
He is, of course, himself
no,
a constitutional lawyer, is he not?
He taught law.
But I'll bet you, Mr. Smallwood, that if it had been your choice, you'd have been here to deal with it here, wouldn't you?
He had no choice. He couldn't determine the date of the Supreme Court handing down, and he couldn't determine the date when he had to
be
in Korea.
Mr. Chretien is on the dais in the National Press Center. Let's pick up the silence.
About 40 minutes of questions, and when you ask your questions...
40 quick
minutes? 40
minutes, no? Oh, no, I'm not in a big rush.
Could I ask you to, when you ask your questions, could I ask you to stand up so that people upstairs could hear? Mr. Chretien.
Mesdames, Mesdemoiselles, Messieurs.
Ladies and gentlemen.
The Supreme Court of Canada has determined that the constitutional proposal of the federal government are legal. I am, of course, very pleased by the decision of the highest court in the land on the cases placed before it by the provinces. Today is a very important day in the history of our country. We have come through a long and difficult period that has been marked by intense debate about the nature of Canada, and whatever side of the debate we have been on, all of us, individual Canadians or and their governments, we have been motivated by a deep desire to make this a better country. Soon, on his return, Parliament will be asked to deal, will be invited to terminate the phase one of the present debate. That will make Canada a truly independent country. 54 years of deadlock will finally have been broken. Canadians at last will have their own constitution. The power of the federal and provincial governments will be restricted in favor of the rights of the individual. There will be guarantees of equality under the law for men and women. The handicapped will be protected from laws which discriminate against them. Our children will be guaranteed the right to an education in English or French anywhere in the country. Our rights to seek a job anywhere in the country will be guaranteed. All Canadians will be protected against laws which discriminate on the basis of race, religion, color, sex, age, or ethnic origin. I am sure that I speak for all Canadians when I say that it is now time to put behind us this constitution debate on which we have focused during the past year. The Supreme Court has dealt with the issue of legality. In 2 weeks from now, Parliament will vote and will express the political desire of the people of Canada. As Minister of Justice and Attorney General of Canada, I cannot overemphasize the importance to our society that the decisions of the Supreme Court of Canada, as the ultimate arbiter of conflict between Canadians, be respected whether or not we agree with them. I am hopeful that political leaders in Canada will put aside their personal feelings about the decision in this case and will do nothing which could encourage disrespect for the Supreme Court and the law. Canadian wants the governments to get on with dealing with the economy, energy, and the promotion of a fair social policies. There is much that we have to do together, and we must start now. Mesdames et messieurs.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Supreme Court of Canada has just decided in favor of the legality of the constitutional proposals of the federal government. Of course, I'm very pleased with this decision by the highest court in the land with respect to the questions that were submitted by certain provinces. It is a very important day in the history of our country. We have just experienced a lengthy and difficult period during which we've had very profound debates on the nature of Canada. Whatever the point of view that we defended, we were all, whether individuals or governments, motivated by a sincere desire to make this a better country to live in. As soon as the House reconvenes, the House of Commons and the Senate will be invited to finish the first phase in the constitutional debate, which will make Canada a truly independent country, and we can finally leave this 54 years of deadlock. Finally, Canadians will have their own constitution. The powers of federal and provincial governments will be in accordance with individual rights. Guarantees will ensure women and men legality before the law. Handicapped people will be protected against discriminatory legislation. Our children will be guaranteed the right to education in French or in English anywhere in the country. And our right to find a job in any area of the country will also be guaranteed. All Canadians will be protected against discriminatory laws with respect to race, religion, color, sex, age, or ethnic origin. I am convinced that I speak on behalf of all Canadians when I say that the time has come to finish this constitutional debate, that we have concentrated our efforts on for the past year. The Supreme Court has dealt with the legality, and in a few weeks, the House of Commons will vote and express the political aspirations of the people of Canada as
Canadian. Commercial break, and then back to Chretien's press conference with the questions from the reporters.
And we should begin immediately. Thank you very much.
First question, Whit Fraser, CBC TV.
Mr. Chretien, do we understand from your statement, though, that even though the Supreme Court has said that the provinces clearly do have a lot at stake and a lot of rights as far as constitutional change is concerned, in spite of that the federal government, as soon as Parliament reconvenes or soon thereafter, will push to have the whole thing resolved within 2 days and that there is no more room for negotiation? Is that the thrust of your speech?
You know, we did not put the question of legality in front of the court. It was the provinces who decided to take the question of legality to the court. And there was a clear decision on legality. Of course, the courts were invited to comment on the constitutional conventions. But we said all along that for 54 years, all the governments have tried to get a unanimity to resolve the problem. And we have come to the conclusion that it was not possible. So we decided to proceed the way we have proceeded. And we intend to finish the job. You know, there is no request at this time, or I don't think in my own mind after I spent 3 months last summer trying to develop a consensus enough that it is possible to have the unanimity to apply it in the present situation. And for me, I don't see at this moment why we should change our course.
Consider negotiating with the Conservatives and the other party in the Commons then to extend it beyond at least 2 days because of the questions raised by the Supreme Court on provincial rights?
You know, there is a decision of the House of Commons that I cannot change. There was a decision taken by the House of Commons with the agreement of everybody that when there will be a ruling by the court, that the Parliament will debate that for 2 days, and at the end of 2 days, there will be a final vote. You know, it was an agreement that was that we didn't like to begin with. We wanted to finish it at that time, and we made that concession to the opposition, so that we had to wait to know if the Supreme Court were to say we're acting legally or illegally. And I think that at this moment, I have to oblige by the decision of the House of Commons. I have no freedom there. And because an order of the House had been passed unanimously.
Michelle Tremblay, Le Journal de Montreal.
Monsieur le Ministre, le jugement dit...
Mr. Minister, the ruling says that your proposal is legal, but it doesn't go along with federalism, and this means that you will continue, but at the risk of breaking up Confederation. I don't think they said that it can break up Confederation. They made comments on the constitutional conventions, and they say in their decision that normally they wouldn't have commented on it because it has no application under the law, but they were called upon to comment on the conventions, and they've noted, just as I have noted myself, that during 54 years we tried to solve the problem by unanimity, and unanimity was not possible. So as far as I'm concerned, I feel that this aspect of their comments doesn't really surprise me, because I myself tried during the entire summer of 1980 to develop a consensus with the provinces, just as my predecessors had done during the previous 53 years. And I personally don't believe that to patriate the Constitution, to bring it back to Canada, to make from the British law, which is our Constitution, a Canadian law, and to give it an amending formula which gives a veto to the province of Quebec, if there's no agreement among the provinces, no unanimity during 2 years, not too many people are discussing that. Now, with respect to the Charter of Rights, I was worried that they might comment and say that the Charter might be illegal in certain respects, and happily, the Supreme Court decided that it was legal, that the program that we had set out is the legal one, and I'm very pleased with that, because I'm convinced that to give Canadians a Charter of Rights and to patriate the Constitution is very desirable. Now, I would put the reverse proposition to you, say that they decide to send the Constitution to England and to abolish the Charter of Rights. Nothing would keep them from doing that. I don't think it would be a very desirable proposal to win an election, but since the Constitution comes back to Canada, they might, with the consent of the provinces, as set out in the amending formula, whether it's accepted or whether we keep the one that we have now if there's no other agreement. Mr. Chretien, what do you intend to do after the vote in the House of Commons in the next few weeks? What do you intend to do vis-a-vis the British government? Well, I said the House would reconvene in 2 weeks. I didn't say we would deal with this in 2 weeks exactly, but in the following weeks, the House will deal with this proposal following the House business. And normally we should then send the resolution to Great Britain. But at this point in time, what I said is that we will eventually, following what the House of Commons has decided, that is, we will proceed with 2 days of debate and then a vote, and the consequence of that is that then the British Parliament will have to deal with the matter.
Opening statement that it's time for Canadians, for Canadian politicians to put this behind them and move ahead. My first question, do you really think that possible? And my second question, isn't it more likely that the federal government action at this point is going to throw the country into a constitutional crisis the likes of which it hasn't seen yet?
You know, I don't think so. I do think that we all had a view, and we debated very strongly. At one time, the provinces claimed that it was illegal what we were doing. We always said at that time that it was a political debate. Now the rule, but the provinces made it a legal problem. Now we have the Supreme Court that has ruled that what we were doing is legal. I do think that when a province doing something legal that we don't like, we have to live with it. So I guess it's the same thing that should apply it in reverse. If we had lost the decision on legality, do you think, I said all along that if it's illegal, we're stopping. But my own view is that now that it has been debated, there is other problems too that have to be dealt with. And I do think that personally, that's the first phase. In the resolution, there is a second phase that is provided for. During the next 2 years after patriation, the provinces will be called upon to meet with the federal government to determine an amending formula and to discuss the native rights. And I don't know what the first ministers will decide. If they want to add something else on the agenda, you know, it will be their problem. But I just say that its first phase is over. The second phase is very, very important, too. But I don't think that this phase should be prostrated, whatever it is, you know, on forever. Because there's other problems.
If I may ask another question, please. In the months following the Quebec referendum, you mentioned several times that you personally found it a very terrible thing to go through, that you wouldn't want to do it again, that it was very important to negotiate as much as possible. Are you prepared now to do it again?
You know, I never said, as we say in French, Fontaine, je ne boirai jamais de ton eau. Well, Fontaine, I will never drink your water. I never said that. I found that very frustrating last year. For 3 months, trying to negotiate, and by the end of it, you know, the stakes were getting higher and higher every day. I think that there will be a second phase. If the Prime Minister asks me to do it as Minister of Justice, I will do it.
What about the possibility of another Quebec referendum?
Oh, I don't like referendums very much. But I think that, you know, what will be the question? You know, I don't know. I just say that when they are acting legally in Quebec, you know, we don't go over their heads. They are acting within their powers, and we're acting within our powers. If it was to be a referendum on separation, I will still fight, because I'm a Canadian. And I do think that the Quebecers have settled that question 18 months ago.
To despise the convention can... will you take that into account, Mr. Poliquin? I always said it was a political problem, and what we undertook, we are prepared to face up to. We're prepared to face up to the political consequences. We said that it would be a political debate, and it will remain so. And once we patriate the Constitution, a new government with the consent of the provinces might undo what we have done. I feel that would be a disaster. I don't think Canadians want us to send the Constitution back to Britain. I don't think Canadians ever want us to abolish the Charter of Rights either. But if all of the governments, or provincial governments at that time, decide to change it, then it will be a political debate. Because if those who want a Charter of Rights are against those who don't want a Charter of Rights, then it will be a political debate. We've always said that it is a political debate. How many times in the House did I refuse to refer this to the Supreme Court because I said it was a political debate, but it was the opposition that led us to agree that this should be sent to the Supreme Court, and the provinces did that as well. And now that the ruling has been made in favor of legality, then as Attorney General of Canada, I'm very satisfied with that decision, because from the very first day, I told my colleagues that what we were doing was legal, and this has just been confirmed by the Supreme Court. The political debate will remain within the area of political debates.
Mr. Chretien, when you think about that court judgment and you see that the justice has decided 9-0 that, in fact, you're infringing on the provinces, and then 6-3 that a convention exists that the provinces should be dealt with, and then finally 7-2 with two justices even saying on the narrow legal question that you're wrong. How do we write that as a victory for the feds?
But I hope you will read the decision on the convention. The judges who have ruled that there was a kind of a convention, they said a convention has nothing to do with the law. And, you know, a convention is in the political arena. When you go in front of the court, you go for the legality. And they say at one time that, you know, they have no choice because the questions were framed like that. But it is not a problem for the court to decide what are the political conventions. It is for the politicians.
Well, aren't they then effectively saying that in a technical legal sense you're correct, but in a political or moral sense, even they think it's debatable?
You know, when you respect the Constitution and you're acting legally, you cannot make a distinction about other things. You know, the the legitimacy and this and that. You know, we went and they took us into court because they claimed we were acting illegally. And we're acting legally. The rest is in the political arena. And we do believe that the Canadian wants to have a Canadian constitution. They are strongly in favor of patriation. And they are in favor of a Charter of Rights. All the Canadians, including me, had wished that we would have had unanimity. I put my best for 3 months to achieve it. But one has to realize what is the reality. And the reality is that after 54 years and the momentum of the referendum from Quebec, the unanimity rule cannot apply. And we, you know, and we cannot, as a nation, be for the rest of our history, still a legal colony of England. Because I always maintain that the only people who can amend the Canadian Constitution is the parliamentarians in London. And I hope that from there on it will be all done in Canada.
John Gray, Globe and Mail.
Mr. Chretien, can you tell me, in political terms, the future for the federal government? Are you contemplating, for example, a federal referendum, despite your distaste for referendum?
You know, I have still the same feeling about the referendum. I don't have any such plan.
Has a plan been drawn up for referendum?
No.
Richard Gwynn, Toronto Star.
Mr. Crady, on the question of a constitution, the court went a good deal further than simply to say that it would breach a constitution or trap practices or traditions. It says that to breach that constitution, that convention would be unconstitutional. I'll read you the quote. It says the agreement of the provinces of Canada is constitutionally required for passing the resolution. And it says further, the passing of this resolution, that is the constitutional resolution, without such agreement would be unconstitutional. How can you show such disrespect to the Supreme Court as to proceed in an unconstitutional manner?
Because the court are called upon to deal with the legality of a situation, they make a very specific statement that I don't have in front of me, that they say the convention has never been transformed in law. They make it very clearly. But we always tried since 54 years. You know, that is, it was the political judgment for 54 years that we should have the consent of the province, but they didn't even move into the area of defining what is a consent. Is it 9 out of 10? Is it 6? Is it this require the agreement of Ontario or not, or Quebec or not? They didn't say it's not our business. So I think that, you know, we have a constitution that is a law in Canada. And they were asked to rule on the legality, and they have ruled on the legality. But I don't disagree with them that for 54 years we have sought to have agreements and that we never achieved it. We knew that we were moving the way we were doing that in a very unprecedented way, but in the legal way.
Luc
Lavoie, TVX.
Mr. Chretien, would you go as far as saying that the Supreme Court should not have answered the other two questions, because you're saying that the court is there to deal with legal matters, and still it answered the two other questions? Do you feel that the Supreme Court went beyond its jurisdiction? Well, the question was put to the Supreme Court. They answered the question by saying that even though there is a convention, it doesn't legally bind the federal government. That is, that to amend the Canadian Constitution, we don't need the consent of the provinces. That's what they're saying in legal terms. They were asked to comment. I have no comment to say about the Supreme Court except to look at what they've decided. And they say very clearly for the second question that even if, in the opinion of certain judges, there is a convention, that this convention does not legally bind the federal government. Those are their words, not mine. If I may ask you a second question, are you prepared to begin another battle with the provincial governments, because this will give additional arguments to the dissident provinces? Well, I'm anxious for the first phase to be finished, because I feel that, especially in Quebec, this perhaps wasn't well enough explained, because patriation is favored by everyone. The Victoria formula, which might be the formula if there's no agreement, gives a veto to Quebec. which, as far as I'm concerned, is the best that our fellow citizens can hope for. With respect to the Charter of Rights, no one really dealt with the Charter of Rights except for the matter of minority language education in Canada. And of course, this is confusing because it would affect in some way Bill 101. But once Quebecers have understood that once these steps have been taken, that Francophones will have a constitutional right to French education in any province and all provinces, just as English-speaking Canadians, this doesn't go as far as I had hoped, but English Canadians would have the same rights in Quebec. Every time I've spoken on this, people were very receptive. But when you exaggerate and say that it will allow everyone to go to English school, that's not quite the case, even though 70% of Quebecers, as far as I can understand, would like a free choice. It's far from free choice because all French Canadians or Italians or Greeks in Quebec won't be able to go to English school. It will only be English-speaking Canadians in Quebec. Now, once this is explained, that there is a convention that exists that when it was before the House of Commons, we didn't publicize the fact, but we might speak about it more someday.
Despite probable and very likely conservative opposition in the House, use closure to get your two-day debate going and also mount a public campaign to convince the public that you are right legally, despite the Supreme Court ruling on the first two questions?
There is no closure possible. We all agree that there will be an end of the debate after 2 days, and it was approved by everyone in the House of Commons. So it's the House of Commons who decided unanimously to have 2 more days of debate after the judgment. It's not me. I wanted to terminate the debate, you remember, in December last year. So I'm a bit late on my program. And so after that, it's not a closure. It's the member of the House of Commons have decided in the spring that 2 more days will be enough. And I agree with them. I voted yes that day.
Chretien, Mr. Clark can change his mind and can hold up Parliament once again. Would the government then try
to... But, you know, I don't want to comment on how many times Mr. Clark changed his mind. In his life, that happened a few times. But, you know, it's not my business. And it's not his business either. The House of Commons, we have decided that. So, you know, it's a binding obligation on the members of the House. We respect the House of Commons, of course.
But Mr. Clark should forget that and respect the agreement.
But, you know, I don't know how he cannot respect that. It's his word, his vote.
I'm not Mr. Clark. I'm sorry, that was unintentional. Mr. Chretien, if the federal government, or does the federal government have a right to, or is legally right, don't you feel that the Parliament in Great Britain might not interpret it in another way and might consider, do you feel they'd consider the legal aspect or perhaps they would consider the conventions? I've always said that the British Parliament and this, I've always said that they have the final word in this debate, and I feel that now they have the confirmation of the legality of our proposal, then since they really are anxious to end this tie between Canada and Great Britain, since they feel that we should deal with our own problems, then I am convinced that they will pass the resolution following what the House of Commons and the Senate vote, just as they've always done since 1867. What would you feel about the Parliament in Great Britain seeing this in another way or interpreting it in another way? Mrs. Thatcher said that she would act according to precedents in the Parliament in Great Britain, and over the past 22 times when Canada asked for changes to the Constitution, they've always acted quickly, and with respect to provincial demands or requests, they've always refused them. So I would assume that the British would be consistent in what they've always done.
You've maintained for months and months and months this was a political question. You'd always thought of it as a political question. Now the Supreme Court says politically in convention it's wrong, but legally it's right. So you're quite willing now to sort of put the political thing aside and run with the legal ball. Isn't there some kind of a contradiction?
No, we have dealt with it politically. You know, when they say that we should have consultation with the provinces, there was a lot of consultation. You know, you remember the Duke and the Duke show last summer? So we were out every day trying to find very sincerely a solution. We've come to the conclusion that an agreement with all the government is not possible. And ask a 20 member there, they will tell you that. And that so we have decided that if, after 54 years, that the deadlock had to be broken. And so we have decided to take the political recourse to do what was legally possible. That means to send a resolution of the House of Commons and the Senate to Westminster. But nobody can say that we have not dealt with the legal, the political aspect of it. You know, I've spent a year and a half of my political career on that. And everyone knows it was not the thing that I wanted to do most in life. But, you know, I've done it. Very sincerely, and I came to the logical conclusion a year ago that we had to take our responsibility and the consequences of what we're doing, you know, as I said, will be political. And as I said in French, if the Progressive Conservative Party or any and the leaders want to run the next campaign on the slogan that will return the Constitution to England or Jerusalem, I don't know, and to abolish the Charter of Rights, that could be their platform. But I do think personally that it is the desire of the Canadians very strongly that we have the Canadian Constitution and the Charter of Rights, and we'll have it. It's too bad that we did not have an agreement. I would have given one arm to get it, but they didn't want to take on one arm. You wanted to have something that was unacceptable for someone who believed that when you have one country, that there is should be enough left for the national government to be a national government.
Question of credibility. Both you and the Prime Minister maintained throughout the process that what you were attempting to do was to give rights to the people, but not to interfere with the juxtaposition of rights between the two levels of government. And on this question, the Supreme Court has gone 9-0 against you. How do you think that this is going to deal with your credibility on that score?
No, on that first question, we said that they were right. That's affecting the provincial powers, just like it's affecting our powers too. You know, we are affected. We're losing powers to the benefit of the Canadians. Taking the Charter of Rights, you know, it will, if we want, for example, to change all the legal rights that are written there. Now the legal rights in the criminal code, it's our all responsibility. When Constitution will be patriated, if we want to change the legal right that exists in the Constitution, we'll need the consent of the province. So we're diverting ourselves from powers in favor of the citizens. And in fact, the provinces will have much more power in relation to legal rights than they had before. But it is for the benefit of the citizens. So we said to that question that we said yes. Mr. Robinette replied that it took 1 minute in the house, in court. He said, we agree. It's affecting our rights and their rights to the benefit of the Canadians as citizens.
And if that?
Chretien has obviously spoken to Trudeau. We'll hear Trudeau this afternoon when he does the satellite bit. The die is cast, gentlemen. Mr. Clyne, are you depressed by the evocative firmness
of Chretien who's saying, we're going straight ahead.
I'm sorry that that decision has been made, because I think it would have been wise and proper if Mr. Trudeau had then called a meeting of the first ministers. Now, in effect, the Supreme Court has said that the Canadian government can legally ask the British Parliament to amend the Constitution of Canada without the consent of the provinces, but it is not right to do so.
Does it mean, does this decision mean that if it wanted to someday, Mr. Smallwood will explore it, someday down the line, the Canadian Parliament now has the power to abolish the provinces?
No, I don't think that I would go that far. But there's another thing, you know, that I really would like to point out in regard to this proposal of Trudeau, that it does give Quebec and Ontario a permanent veto.
And the Senate, too.
And I think it's a dangerous document. I think the Charter of Human Rights is a bad document. And I'm afraid that if it is implemented, it can, not in the immediate future, but eventually destroy the unity of Canada.
Mr. McWhinney.
The court has given a clear answer that it is law. Mr. Chretien is taking what I would call a very British position, that what is law, the conventions are not law, and I expect Mrs. Thatcher will respond in the same spirit. So I think it's clear. We're on to phase two of the Constitution now. The government will go ahead, and maybe there's a case for that in the sense that it's time to put the things behind us. But the government has clearly foreclosed the issue of re-examining the issue of renegotiation.
Mr. Smallwood, you said this is the first of three happy days that you're looking forward to. Well, starting today.
Three happiest days, I said. Not happy, happiest. As a Canadian. Not as a Newfoundlander, not as a human being, but as a Canadian. 32 years I've been a Canadian. And today is the first of the three happiest days of my life as a Canadian.
The other two are what?
The other two will be, the second one will be when, after the 2 days additional debate in the Canadian Parliament, they put the final vote. And the third happiest of the three happy days, the third will be the day when the Parliament of the United Kingdom passes it.
I see. And it's 54 years of trial and tribulation now overcome.
That's right.
Trial and tribulation.
And I was one of the 54 years. I was at the Victoria Conference, the nearest we ever did come to agreement with Ottawa.
And anybody who dares to go against this positive move is guilty of some kind of lack of understanding of how to be a Canadian. Is that right?
Well, lack of my particular understanding. Others have their own understanding.
Insofar as it affects Newfoundland, but I would like to know what Mr. Smallwood thinks in respect of Newfoundland, if the Supreme Court, as I understand it, has said that they cannot alter the
terms of agreement
between Newfoundland and Canada. Well, and I feel quite certain that this will alter those terms of agreement.
I said that as a Canadian, these are the three happiest things of my life. As a Newfoundlander, I'm very happy to have this thing read out from Ottawa by this...
Robinson.
Yes, to the effect that they can't do it.
No.
They cannot. And therefore, of course, they will not.
That might be the one untouchable
thing in federal law.
Except it may politically be of no great significance. I think we really have to see what...
It's as a Newfoundlander that I take that position.
I see. That today you're wearing your all-Canadian hat.
That's right.
Gentlemen, in case I don't get a chance later, and perhaps we will, I want to express my great thanks to you, the Honourable J.V. Clyne, to you, Professor McWhinney, and to you, sir, the former Premier of Newfoundland. Back to the press conference.
Not the immigrants, but the Canadians who arrive in Montreal or Shawinigan are speaking English. Unfortunately, there is less and less of that type. In Shawinigan, they all vote for me, and it's less than 1%. But you know, when they understand that they will keep their English cool for them, and in return, the Francophone across Canada will have the right to French schools, something that they never had since 1867. They think that it's a pretty good deal. But we have to explain it.
No, one last question. The man next to Richard Gwynn.
Rory Leishman, London Free Press, Mr. Chretien. I am utterly baffled by this decision. I think it's unprecedented that the Supreme Court should state that something is legal but unconstitutional in the conventional sense, and formally declare it to be unconstitutional in the conventional sense, and then for the Justice Minister of Canada to say it is not for the courts to decide what is conventional, it is for the politicians, and then for you to say that the British parliamentarians should abide by the conventions of their constitution, but that the Parliament of Canada, or the Government of Canada, should feel free to violate a convention of the Constitution as defined by the Supreme Court.
Yeah, but you're
not setting a very dangerous precedent here by ignoring what the Supreme Court says is a binding convention of the Constitution.
They say that it's not binding in law. You have your answer. There, they say it's not binding in law. We have a written constitution in Canada that was given to us in 1867. And the British Parliament retained at that time the power to amend the Canadian Constitution. And we're asking them to return the Constitution plus a Charter of Rights for the Canadians. They don't have a written constitution in England. But the court decided here that they recognized that there was an evolution in the last 50 years, 54 years, where everyone was aiming at having the unanimous consent. But they say that this has not gelled as yet into law. And legally, we can do what we're doing. You know, it's exactly what I've argued all along. I did recognize that desire, political desire that existed since 54 years, when I spent my summer last year to try to get an agreement. And I put a lot of things on the table to get them to agree, to patriate the Constitution, have an amending formula, and gave the Canadian a Charter of Rights. And you read the judgment. I read part of it. Of course, I have to, you know, but I'm satisfied that we always said that. That conventions, it's in the political arena, and you pay the political price. I will give you an example of political conventions. In 1968, there was a political convention. Then when you lose a bill in the House of Commons on a fiscal bill, it's a defeat in the confidence of a government. Mr. Pearson went back to the House, did not follow the political convention, and we won the confidence of the House despite of the political convention. And since that time, that was an old British tradition. When I was Minister of Finance, I used to joke with Dennis Healy, who was the Chancellor of the Exchequer, because from month to month, he was losing some fiscal bills or some votes on his budgets, and he was telling me, thank you, Jean, you created a new precedent that is very useful. So, you know, that is what is a political convention. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you.
Of the Supreme Court of Canada today indicates very clearly the view of the court in their that in their language, in their words, the resolution of the Trudeau government regarding the Constitution is unconstitutional in the conventional sense. I think what is most important about the Supreme Court decision is the care that the judges took and that the court took to divide the third question, to deal with both law and the question of constitutionality, convention, and tradition. They have underlined the fact that in a system like ours, the Constitution of Canada involves both strictly legal matters and constitutional conventions or traditions. What the Trudeau government is doing in its resolution would violate the constitutional traditions of our country, Canada. I'll quote the relevant section from the judgment on page 41 in the English version. The agreement, we have reached the conclusion that the agreement of the provinces of Canada, no views being expressed as to its quantification, is constitutionally required for the passing of the proposed resolution for a joint address to Her Majesty respecting the Constitution of Canada, and that the passing of this resolution without such agreement would be unconstitutional in the conventional sense. Now, in the circumstances for the government of Canada to try to proceed with its resolution would be destructive of national unity and would be absolutely wrong for this country. Now, we all know the divisions that exist in this country. There's no doubt at all that an attempt to proceed with this resolution would aggravate and deepen those divisions. A prime minister has a duty to try to bring his nation together. He has a duty to put the priorities and the needs of the nation ahead of his own personal agenda. And clearly, in a circumstance like this, when the Supreme Court of Canada has ruled that the conventions of our Constitution, the traditions of our Constitution would be violated by proceeding this way, the Prime Minister of Canada should not risk deepening divisions in this country by pushing forward with his own proposal. In my judgment, now is the time for all of us who are interested in constitutional reform to get together in Canada to find ways by which we can reform in Canada our Constitution. The Prime Minister must not proceed with his attempt to change the Constitution of Canada in a way that has been declared by the Supreme Court of Canada unconstitutional in a conventional sense. If he does continue, we will oppose him absolutely. Je vais répéter, refaire la déclaration.
I will repeat my statement in French. I believe that the most important thing in this historical decision by the Supreme Court today is the determination of the court to separate the third question, to emphasize that in a system such as ours, there are two elements to the Canadian Constitution, and the question of, there's a question of strict legality, but there's also the element of conventions and traditions of a constitution. The Supreme Court decided today that the Liberal government's resolution would violate the traditions.
Mr. Clark is repeating precisely in French the statement you just heard. Quick commercial break and back.
Man or then an attitude towards a constitution, and for the Prime Minister to continue with his project.
You heard Mr. Clark. It's wrong to proceed now. Unconstitutional in a conventional sense. Trudeau's actions will cause deep aggravated wounds in the country. Mr. McWhinney, briefly, your reaction to Clark's statement.
It is a political joinder issue. The Prime Minister's made the political decision to go with the law and he expects Mrs. Thatcher to respond on the law.
Clark
takes the political decision to oppose.
Mr. Clyne.
I agree with Clark in that he says that the Supreme Court has decided that it is legally correct to proceed, but morally wrong. And in that case, I certainly think that the matter should go back to a meeting of the First Minister.
Do you agree with Clark that this will deepen and aggravate divisive wounds in this country?
I entirely agree. I think it will be divisive of Canada in the long run.
Before I come to Mr. Smallwood, you didn't give me a political interpretation of your own. Is it bad for Canada to proceed now, as Clark says?
I think the younger premiers may respond more pragmatically and get on with phase two because they have other options. His position's more difficult.
And Mr. Smallwood.
Well, I think he's wrong. I think he's very wrong. But I would defend to the death his right to be wrong.
I suppose you would. Mind you, don't you think that the Peckfords and the Bennetts and the Lougheeds, especially Bennett and Lougheed, they've been playing a lot closer to the feds than they have been in recent months, haven't they?
Yes, they have, and they've been getting a little satisfaction.
Succeeding
here
by
and there.
Co-op diplomacy.
Happy man, it's Mr. Smallwood. unhappy man is Mr. Clyne, and the man in the middle looking at it clinically is...
It's theatre. It's high theatre, not
And law. I'm indeed grateful to these three gentlemen, the Honourable J.V. Clyne, Professor McWhinney, and the former Premier, the happy man, Joey Smallwood. Full coverage on the new news and news hour tonight, and I'll be back tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. precisely.
Deep in divisions in the country. He has the choice. I hope he will act in the Canadian interest, respect the Canadian way, and not...